things that we mostly won't understand, but we'll all be on anyways. So enjoy.
Which happens, by the way, because I never actually choose a topic or a title or anything until I get here. And so John just makes up stuff and sticks it in the So, hi, I'm Jay Freeman. You may remember me from such inscrutable 360 iDev talks as Missing Obvious Signals and Script, a JavaScript Objective-C Java REPL hybrid. So today I'm going to be teaching you how to build a computer, a fairly normal CPU architecture, assuming nothing but a belief in magnetism and an understanding of place-based arithmetic. And actually, as part of that I was supposed to have with me the one little outline to make sure I don't do things in wrong order, and I forgot to put that up here with me, so give me one second. I have that now. Okay. So many people here always see me as the person who does all this work with jailbroken iPhones, and I give all these talks on low-level implementation details of iOS. People ask me, how do you get to learn things about low-level stuff? And it's problematic, actually, because it's not really even clear where to begin, where in the middle of low-level. A lot of people think about things that are low-level, and I think of those, that's actually really high-level. Even assembly level is useful. I mean that's like a good place to start, but you're gonna have a difficult time understanding assembly if you don't have some understanding of the basic architecture of a computer. So what we're gonna try to do today, and I say try as if we're gonna really fail or something, we're almost certainly gonna succeed, is we're going to go through in the next around 45 minutes most of the cool parts, at least, of a computer architecture class and an electrical engineering class. So I teach. It's not totally crazy. I actually teach at a university, and I do computer science for non-computer people quite often. Okay, so again, I'm going to assume only a belief in magnetism and a understanding of place-based arithmetic. So the presentation mechanism I use is I'm going to be drawing a lot, essentially as if I had a blackboard, and occasionally, every now and then, there's something in the tool is going to end up confusing me. I'm sorry about that. All right. So we're going to begin with wire. Wire transfers electricity. Okay. It starts very easy. We'll get a little more complicated, but hopefully not too complicated. All right. So sources of power look like this, and we typically have power more moving towards what we call ground. Now, the metaphor here is something like water, where you have a reservoir of water, which due to gravity is moving the water flowing towards ground. Now, in practice, of course, electricity can flow in any which way. But that's also somewhat where these symbols can end up coming from, because also, the ground is as you know from lightning rods, is a giant sink for electricity. All right, the next symbol we're going to get into is an electromagnetic coil, and this is where your belief in magnetism and maybe some memory of a high school physics class will come in handy. Maybe even just elementary school, if you had ever just taken a wire, wrapped it around a nail, attached it to a battery, and went, ooh, it's a magnet. That's really all we need here. So we're going to attach part of this to ground, and we're going to then have a switch. This switch is going to be made out of a metallic substance, which, and this is again the one thing you just have to trust from old physics classes, when power goes in a circle, an electromagnetic field is formed, causing magnetic to move down like that, and so we will actually pull this piece of metal downwards. But it'll normally be attached upwards with a spring. So in this way, we can put power here, control whether the coil is on or off, use that to move the switch at the top of this diagram. That is an electromagnetic relay. So now I'm going to show you a picture from Wikipedia, which is a diagram of a relay. A photograph of a relay. So here is that electromagnetic coil. Here is a giant block of metal that coil will be able to move. Here are two contacts and a little piece of like a copper clapper in between. This giant piece of metal and then the piece of copper attached to it will move up and down whether based on this spring, which is levering down, or based on the electromagnetic coil, which when turned on will cause a magnetic field which will draw down the giant piece of metal. Moving back to drawing diagrams. So next thing I need to is a little an idiom that we'll have is that if two wires cross, they are not touching. They're only touching if I draw a little circle on them indicating a junction is at that point. Now, with this, we're going to start using these symbols in order to like just do, well, we got wire and junction so far, in order to do some basic logical thought. So, A and B. We're going to represent inputs into our system, whether we have power or no power. So if we have power somewhere, then we will say A is on, and if we don't, then A is off. We would like to ask the question, is one or both of A or B on? One simple way of doing this is to simply attach a junction. This would be wrong. And the reason why is that if we have C, and we then ask the question B or C, power is totally happy to flow in two directions. And so electricity will flow from C back through the entire system and will turn on A or B, even though A or B has absolutely nothing to do with C. So we're going to need a little more sophisticated here. We're going to build something called a buffer, which will isolate power and make it only allowed to move in one direction. And effectively, that is exactly what a relay is. So if we look back at our relay, if we simply attach this switch to power and we put A here, only if A is on will this bottom part of the switch turn on. If A is off, then that bottom part of the switch will be off. But if you put power back here, it will either go nowhere, or if the switch is down, it will, actually I should erase just to make that much more clear. If the switch is down, power will go back only to where power came from. So it will not affect any of the rest of our circuit. The symbol we'll use for a buffer, which is going to include all of this stuff in it, is a triangle. A comes in, A comes out, but A can only go in one direction. So now if we wanted to go and use this buffer in order to implement that OR we were looking at before, A, B, now when power comes in from C, it will get stopped before it can go back and affect anything that is coming with B. All right. Now, another thing you might want to be able to do is to ask for the opposite of something. And if we look back at our relay, that is simply connecting the other part of the switch. So, if we would like to have A and we would like to know the opposite of A, we will simply look at the top wire. We call this not. And the symbol for not looks like this. A on the left, not A. Not A on the right. Okay. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to ask the question, if we have A and B on the left, we would like something which only turns on if both A and B are on. We can do this. Again, looking down at our relay. Connect that better. This circuit will do that. So if B is off, then the switch will go up, so it doesn't matter what A is. If A is off, even if B is on, then we will not have power going over to the right. Only if both the electromagnetic coil is on and there is power coming along the top switch will the wire on the right be on. And we've added a buffer just to make certain that power never flows backwards through the circuit and affects the input of A. So we now have this OR we've put together, we also have pictures for those. So AND looks like this. And OR looks like this. And OR. The way that I tend to remember these difference between these is that AND, the letter A, has straight slanty lines on it, and the letter O for OR is circular and round. And so AND has a straight line, and OR has a curved line. Now on this or when we said it, it was actually it was A or B or both. That's not how humans normally think of the word or. If I tell you to go to the store and buy this or that, and you come back with both, I might think you're just kind of wasting money. I told you I only needed one or the other one, not both. But when we look at logic and we think about or, and if most of this audience is computer programmers, you know this, we have another operator which is called exclusive or. So exclusive or is only A or B and not both. And the way that I just described it is exactly how you can implement it. A, B, A, or B, and not both A and B. A XOR B. The symbol for exclusive OR is like OR, but it has an extra curvy bit on it. I'm sorry that my curvy bits are so horribly not curvy. Well, at least they're not straight. That is the important thing to differentiate them from AND. So while I'm here, I'm going to point out that you will sometimes see this not can be put here because it is simply a circle as one of the inputs, or it can be put here. Circle is an output. If you can attach that circle to anything. If you think about it, the circle was simply attached to the buffer in order to make the output of the buffer become opposite. The circle can then be attached to an AND gate to get the opposite of an AND gate, which we call NAND. The circle can also sometimes, you'll see, be attached, as I said, to the input of a gate in order to flip just one of the inputs. All right. So the interesting thing about XOR is that XOR is effectively math. So typically in programming languages, for the computer programmers out there, you'll have bitwise arithmetic, and then you'll have mathematical arithmetic, and almost never the twixt shall meet. But in fact, if you think about what XOR is doing, we are simply adding two numbers, 1 and 0. 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 0 is 1, and 1 plus 1 is 10 base 2. If you're only looking at the rightmost digit, that is exclusive OR. The second digit, which here is simply implicitly 0 and is there 1, is AND. So to add a 2, 1 digit, 2 base 2 numbers, to get a 2 digit base 2 number, you are doing 1 exclusive OR and you're doing 1 AND. So let's look at that. We have two numbers, A and B. We're going to add them together. We will do an exclusive OR, and that will be the sum. And then we will do an AND, and that will be the carry. This circuit we call a half adder. Why is it only a half adder? Well, the reason it's a half adder is that if you try to add more than one digit numbers, I did it again. You try to add more than one digit numbers, you're going to end up having to add three at a time. Because 1 plus 1 is 10 with a carry of 1. And now you have to add 1, 0, and 0, and 1 in order to get 10. And then you have to add 1, 1, and 1 in order to get 11, and then in order to get 1,100 base 2. So we actually have to think through how to handle this as a full addition. Thankfully, a full add is simply two half adders, which is exactly why we call it a half adder. So we have A, we have B, we have the previous carry. What you can do is if you just take these two numbers and you add them together with a half adder, you will get a sum, which if you add it with another half adder, you will get another sum. Then each one of these half adders will also have a carry. Now the question is, what do we do with these carries? When we were doing the math before, we only had one carry. How are we going to combine these two carries into one carry? So, if the top half adder gave you a carry, if the carry line ended up being on, that means that we were adding 1 and 1, because the only thing you can use to get a carry is 1 plus 1. It's 1. 1 plus 1 will always have a sum of 0. 0 plus anything will not have a carry. So if the first carry is on, the second carry will not be on. And if the first carry is off, well, whatever the second carry is, that means we can actually just, we only ever have one or the other on at a time, possibly neither. We can just attach the two wires together with a junction, and that will give us the next carry. So we can now look at this in terms of a multi-digit number. We have A and B, the first digits of them, the zeroth digits of them, coming into a half adder. We then have a sum, the zeroth digit. A carry comes out, attaching to the next full adder, which then adds to the next numbers, and we get the next digit coming out. And then it will come in, and we will then get the next digits, A2 and B2, and we will continue adding two half adders, and get the numbers, and carry it across. And that is how we can add a multi-digit number. Now, representing multi-digit numbers using very large numbers of circuits is incredibly infuriating. So we're going to have another symbol that makes it easier to talk about many numbers, many lines of power at a time, and that is a bus. A bus is a wire with a slash through it. Sometimes you'll see a number indicating how many wires there are. So this bus has 8 wires, and you can think about that as an 8-digit number, an 8-digit base 2 number. So if you want to add these together, we're going to build a thing, which is just what we just built. We will call it an arithmetic logic unit. An arithmetic logic unit will take two buses as input and return a bus. It will do math. Now, one common operation is addition. That's all we figured out how to do so far. Most arithmetic logic units will have some other wires coming in, making it do other things. We're only going to do addition. Addition sufficient. So when we see the symbol, this is an arithmetic logic unit that will do addition. Now, one thing we haven't done so far is we have not had any way of remembering anything. We've been just doing calculations. Our computers also have memory. So we're going to have to build something called a latch in order to remember things. A latch is a circular circuit. Actually. Two lines coming in the left, one line coming out on the right, and as you see things, like it goes, there's a circle in the middle here, where power is going through this figure eight. So how does this work? If I turn this first line on, this is an OR gate. The OR gate, we don't care what the other wire is, it will be on. The NOT will turn off. So we know this line is off. Which means that this is off, and doesn't, because we haven't turned this on, I should have said that. We did not turn that on. So now this NOT is on, which will hold that original OR gate on. Even if we let go, even if we turn this off, this is a stable state of this circuit. The original OR gate we turned on momentarily, which caused the bottom OR gate to turn off, which makes the top OR gate be on. Now let's flip the circuit. The way we do this is we put power here, which will destabilize the system. It will cause this OR gate to turn on, which will cause this to turn off, which will make the top OR gate no longer be held on. It will turn off. So the NOT gate will turn on, causing power to come out, and hold the bottom OR gate on. Now, when we let go of this bottom part, the circuit will again be stable, but it will be in the opposite configuration. In case you're at all curious, you may be asking, how is it just stable forever? Where if you remember, all of the gates were built out of relays, and many of our relays had power just getting into them. So there's a bunch of little circuits that are inside of here, all little relays that all have power. It is being powered. The question is just whether it remembers which of the two states it's in, not how it just seems to run forever. This is called an RS latch. And the reason why is because of the weird way that computer people use reset and set. So we have an output on the right, and when we want to turn that output on, we will set it on. So we will set the circuit. When we want to put the circuit back to the initial configuration of that being off, we will reset the circuit. So to set the circuit, you give power to S. To reset the circuit, you give power to R. And you can always see what the current state of the circuit being set or not is on the right-hand side. Now, that's nice, but it is actually from the perspective of an interface that we're going to work with electronics, actually kind of annoying. So we're going to fix that by wrapping it in something else. Spell that better. R reset RS latch. So RS latch has R and S, S, and then has that output Q. We're going to put it inside of a larger circuit, which has a different interface, D, and C, which stands for data and control. The idea here is that we're going to make the RS latch remember whether the D wire is on or off the last time we use the control wire. So if we want to turn the circuit on, we're going to give power to the D wire and touch the control wire. Let go of control, and now it will remember that the last time control was touched, data was on. If we want to turn it off, we're not going to put power on data, and we're going to touch control, and the circuit is supposed to remember that the last time we touched control with power, data was off. And the way we do this is by taking the data line and attaching it to either R or S, depending on whether C is on. And we can do that using AND gates. So we would like to set the circuit if control is on and data is on. And we would like to reset the circuit if control is on and if data is off. I'm terribly sorry about the lines here. That's okay. There, let's make that a little bit easier to read. Okay. So the power will only get to either R or S if C is on, and then whether it is R or S will be based on whether D is on. And then the output, we will just output to the outside, and so we've got our output Q, and now we have what is known as a gated D latch. The control wire is sometimes called a gate line, and so that is why we've got this terminology of a gated D latch. All right. Now remembering on or off is great, but computers typically remember many more than that. I mean, many large numbers of ons and offs. We would like to be able to remember a number, if nothing else. And so to do that, we're going to put together multiple RS latches. So we will have an RS latch and another RS latch. And we will have a data bus coming in and a control line coming in. And then we will have on the output an output bus. And the way that this will work is we will just take our control line and attach it to both of the internal RS latches. And then we will have the data bus will come in. We'll split it into two wires. And I'm sorry, I don't have a good way of representing splitting into two wires. So I'm going to keep doing this funny little curve thing and point out very explicitly that I had a bus and now I've got two wires. And I will attach one to this and the other to this. And then I've got two Qs coming out, and I will kind of merge them together into a single bus coming out. And so I will now have a 2-bit, what we call a register. Registers have multiple RS latches inside of them. They can remember a number in the base of the size of the register. In this case, we can remember a base 2, 2-digit number. Okay. But again, remembering one number is also not worthy of a computer. Computers need to remember large numbers of numbers. So we're gonna need to build some more circuits. We're gonna build something called a selector. A selector takes multiple wires on one side and selects one of them to attach to the wire on the other side, based on whether a control wire on the bottom is on or off. Well, you might remember, and I mean, if you think through all the circuits that we've so far done, it's actually that description sounds very much like a relay, which has an electromagnetic coil you turn on or off and off, and it makes a switch connect one wire to one of two different wires. So if we simply connect this up as if it were a relay, we get exactly that behavior. Now, this circuit goes in either direction. So if you have one wire on the right and you want to connect it to one of two wires on the left, that's the same thing as one of two wires on the left and one wire on the right. Power goes in both directions, as we unfortunately had to learn earlier. You can also build bigger selectors. So if I have four wires coming in on the left, I can use multiple selectors inside. In order to get one wire coming out on the right. And instead of only one wire coming in at the bottom, I'll have two wires coming in on the bottom. One of these two wires will control, and there's a reason why I'm gonna cross, will control these two, and the other one will control this one. Why'd I do it in that order? Because if you look at A and B down here, and we now we're label A, B, A, B, A, B, etc. You were do this in 0, 0, and 1, we will have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. The rightmost wire here is controlling whether we are going to use the rightmost most digit, because this is controlling whether we are going to take from here or here, and this one is controlling whether we're taking from here or here. And the leftmost digit is controlling whether we're going to go from the entire top half or the entire bottom half. And so we've effectively taken now a number, and we're using that number in order to index a set of wires, which are all numbered. We could, of course, expand this up to as many digits as we would like to have. We could have 8 wires coming on the left, add another layer of 4 of the 1 of 2 selectors, and we could then have 8 to 1. And we will use this to finally build a memory circuit. Memory is simply a large number of registers, large such as 2. So we have data coming in on the left, and we have a control wire. We have a control wire coming in on the bottom. And we have a control wire coming in here. We're going to have an output here. It always gets me. We have an output there. And the way we're going to build this is we're going to take that data line, and we're going to attach it to all of the data bus, the entire data bus. We're going to attach all of the wires of that bus to all of the internal registers. And then we're going to take the control circuit, and we're going to put it through a selector in order to select either the top register or the bottom register. Now, how are we going to select one of them? We're going to have a wire coming into here. And of course, we're probably going to have more than 2 registers, and so this is going to end up eventually being a bus. That will come down here. That is what we call the address. The address is the number of the register in the very large number of registers that are in memory that we will use in order to read something or write something into this memory region. So now we've got to figure out a way to get things out. And this is where the symbology is a little bit annoying. So we're going to have 2 buses coming out here. Each one of these buses, we're going to split into its individual wires. We're then going to take the first wire of each and the second wire of each, and we're going to run each of them through a selector. And we're going to take the results, and we're going to merge them into the output bus. And that selector is going to also be selected by the address. So again, now memory is just a large number of registers where we have an address bus deciding which one we are working with. That address decides which register's output we will see. And it also decides which register we are controlling when we attempt to make a register remember something using the data line. Now you might think, Jay's been talking for a while and he's only gotten memories, how's this gonna work? Well, we're actually now it's all gonna start falling together. So we're going to use a data bus in order to represent a number that we're interested in working with. And maybe we want to remember it. So we're gonna have a register that we're going to attach to it. Call that register X. Now, registers have a control line and they have an output. I'm going to be representing control lines with little green circles. And I'm also going to have these little AND gates that I'm going to attach back to these buses, which are going to allow us to decide whether this bus is attached to the data bus back or not. And so that's an eraser. That's also going to have a control line on it. And it'd be nice to be able to put something on the data bus. And so let's decide that all of the wires of the data bus, we're never going to directly attach power to them, except one of them. And that could be either 1 or 0. So I'm just going to split this off like this, and then we're going to have one of them controlling there, 1 or 0. So now if we want to remember a 0, we can put power to here, and that will store the nothing that's on the data bus into that register. If you want to remember 1, we will first make the data bus say 1, and then we will store that number into X. Now, we'd like to be able to store more than one thing, so let's just add one more register here called Y, and we will draw it the same way with the same little bits of control. Now we can transfer, if we have a value 5 in x, we can transfer 5 by reading it to the data bus and then writing from the data bus to y, which will store the number 5 in y. So now we can transfer values between these two registers. We'd also like to be able to do math. So we're going to take the output of these two registers, and we will just have them always constantly attached to an arithmetic logic unit, which will be adding them together and storing them into an output register we will call q. But only if we want to. Control lines always. And so you'll see this register to notice is I've its control is on the other side. It's backwards from the other two registers. So it's being written to on the right. So the writing to part is always gonna be where the control line is. And then we will have on this side it is attached optionally to the data bus. And so now if we wanted to add the values that are in x and y, we would be able to do that by putting power to here. Oh, eraser again. By putting power to here, which will turn on writing to q. So now x plus y will be stored in q. And now we could, for example, transfer the value of q to y, and then add x and y back into q, and then transfer the value of q into y. And by this way, we could have some repeated additions that we could be performing. And it's a little bit tricky because we only have these three registers to store things into, but you can end up building something like a multiplication out of this. Now, three registers, not enough. Let's put in some memory. So memory, I'll put in over here. Actually, I always draw it a little low. Memory we'll put in over here. Memory is also going to be attached to the data bus, and it has a control line on it. It also though has it has the ability to read from it. But if you remember, it has that address bus. That was the whole point of the memory, is that the memory had an address to decide which of the many parts of memory you're using. So we're just going to add another bus called A for address bus. I'll write out address. All right, I'll put giant M for memory. So now, when we want to read from something in memory, we will turn on reading from memory, and we'll have to somehow put the right value on the address bus. Well, how are we gonna do that? Well, let's add another register to our computer called A, which you can optionally write to the address bus, and which will take its value potentially from the data bus. So now we can calculate addresses on the data bus, store them into the A register, put the value of the A register onto the address bus by turning this control wire on, and then read from that location in memory and store that value in Y. Now the next step, I mean, I need you to trust me for just a couple minutes. And the trust that I need from you is that you are willing to believe that I can represent anything this computer can do with a number. Now, of course, many people in this audience are computer programmers, and so the idea that you can represent anything as a number seems almost obvious, but for many people who are not computer people, that just is the most crazy thing ever. And you also, though, might not see how to represent this as a number, because this is a very specific thing. I mean, I might understand how to represent a building as a number, but not a person as a number. I'm gonna show you how to represent this, and this is a number, but not yet. I need you to believe me for a few minutes. And the reason I need you to believe me that I can store these things as things, that what the computer can do as a number, is that I need to be able to store what the computer can do in memory. So somewhere in memory is a sequence of numbers, which represent things that we want the computer to do in sort of sequential order. And we also know where we currently are in that program, is what we call it. That's the program counter, is another register, which has the address of a location in memory. So we need to be able to put that over here. Also, because programs, we had that concept of sequential. We want to be able to go from one step to the next step to the next step to the next step. We need to be able to increment the program counter. We need to be able to add one to the program counter to go to the next instruction, the next step of our computer. So I'm going to add another register, which is called T. And T is going to be attached to a arithmetic logic unit with the value of the program counter, which is always the other side is simply the number 1, plus 1. And then the program counter can be controlled from the data bus, and the temporary register can be written to the data bus. So now we're going to look at but when we finally get the instruction that we have, the thing we want to have performed out of memory, we're going to need a place to put that. And so I'm going to add one final register, which we call the instruction decode register. and the instruction decode register can be written from the data bus. So now we can look at what the steps that this computer are going to perform are. The first step is we're going to put the program counter on the address bus, read that value from memory of what that current step, that current instruction is. We're going to store that in the instruction decode register, and simultaneously we're going to store into the temporary register the address of the next instruction. That first step we're going to call fetch. The next step, we're going to take the temporary register and just copy it to the program counter to go to the next step. So the next time we do this, we will be using the next instruction. And this is the second step of our computer. We'll call it move. And then the third step of our computer is to somehow take this number, which is in the instruction decode register, and use it to make the computer do something. Now, I'm going to tell you, when you take a computer architecture class and you see people give this presentation, they now spend about as much time as I've spent doing all of this trying to explain the incredibly complicated mechanism by which you convert computing into numbers. But because of the way that I defined all of this, we actually just have to look at all these green circles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. We have 16 green circles. All the things that the computer can do are decided based on turning on some subset of these green circles. If we had a 16-bit bus, if we had a 16-digit base 2 number, we would be able to decide which of the many configurations of all of these green circles we're going to turn on and turn off, and that is controlling the computer. Now, it is true that there are some really, really weird things that will allow. There are some instructions which do absolutely horribly horrible things to our computer. By the way, that's realistic. There was a time I was working with a friend on a robot for a play, and the robot caught on fire, and I was very confused. He was the electrical engineer, I was a software engineer, and I'm like, how did that happen? And he asked me, well, did you turn these two variables on at the same time? And I look at it, and I'm like, that would catch it on fire? And he's like, yeah, you're just literally shorting power directly back to ground. And I'm like, wow, okay. So there have been computers where the idea of like a halt and catch fire instruction that the computer can perform. So this third step is execute. And where we just take all of the wires from here and we attach them with an AND gate to every single place, and that AND gate, the other side of it is, are we on step 3? So step 1, we turn on the 4 wires that will copy from memory to the instruction decode register. Step 2, we turn on the 2 wires that will transfer the temporary register's next program counter value to the program counter. Step 3 is we execute. Now, step 3 can do all sorts of things. Step 3 can transfer numbers for numbers, it can add numbers, it can change the program counter, because the program counter is on the data bus, and it's one of the things that you can read and write to, such that the next time you fetch instructions. So this gives you complete control over the order that the instructions can happen. You can have an instruction that says go back to the beginning and start over again and just do this forever. This is computing. It's still a little annoying, though, that we have to have a person going and just touching this thing with these little wires. So we're going to build one more little thing, and it's a very analog thing. We're going to have a hand crank. And the hand crank is going to have 3 wires coming next near it, not quite touching it. And it's going to have a little metal flap coming off of it, such that as you turn the hand crank and starts rotating around, this flap first touches here, and then it kind of bends further and further and further, and then eventually it snaps over the other side. And then it touches here, and it bends further and further and further until finally it snaps over the other side. And then we're going along all 3 of these, and we'll keep going. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The other side, the center of this, is going to be attached to power, so that the little flap represents power. And we will attach one of these to the program counter, and to memory, and to the temporary register, and to, there's supposed to be 4. The memory, and the instruction decode register. And we'll attach the second one. We will attach just to the temporary register there, and the program counter there. And the third one will be attached to the numerous AND gates that control the instruction decode register. Now we've got this ludicrous diagram. But now all we're doing is turning a hand crank, and we have to have power. Okay, well, if you actually have an electromagnetic coil inside of here, moving around a magnet, you move the magnet through the coil in the other direction. Well, that's just like the relay in reverse. If you again trust your high school physics, you can generate power like that. So now we've actually gotten rid of the requirement for where power comes from. Power comes from our hand crank. And if we just could find a waterfall in order to put all of this underneath it, to have the waterfall turn the crank for us, we can walk away. And we now have a fully automatic computer. And so I actually, part of my phone that has the time on it is broken, and so I actually don't know how I ended up doing on time. But I think I see a 3, so I think I'm actually fairly close to not being that far over, if I'm over at all. So this is how you build a computer, given only a belief in magnetism, an understanding of place-based arithmetic, and a very large amount of wire and maybe a waterfall. Thank you very much. Does anyone have any quick questions? Yeah. Well, so actually, the real computer is the hand crank is the clock. Yeah, the thing is going from step one, step two to step three, and then the waterfall is the wall. Yeah, I mean, the waterfall might actually be a literal waterfall somewhere. So, yeah, and so computers have represent this with a clock, and one of the interesting things is that electricity has a speed, and so it takes time for, if you remember that, it's particularly the adder that we had a number of wires coming on the top, and power had to flow from one side of the diagram through numerous circuits back up, and had to get all the way to the other side before it would work. The amount of time it takes power to go through the slowest possible computation is the speed at which your clock cannot be faster than. Like, if you turn your hand crank too fast, you will go back to fetch before you finished executing the previous instruction. And that is then when you hear about people overclocking computers. What they're doing is they're trying to figure out how to make electricity go faster by like liquid cooling it, and then turning the clock up. Or sometimes it's just that the computer was literally fine running at that faster speed, but Intel couldn't find anyone who was willing to pay more for it, and so they purposely slowed it down and sold it as a slower. That also happens. But that's also why like overclocked computers will sometimes work and then sometimes glitch, and that's why they are doing all the cooling is because of that clock aspect. Any other questions?
Can you just elaborate on the place-based qualification?
Yeah. So I keep saying you need to know place-based arithmetic. When I did 1 + 1 + 1 is equal to 10. If you're not willing to accept that 1 + 1 can equal 10 in base 2, then this really gets really confusing. And so it's There's some people have done math. Like, so by the way, I was really happy that I found out that John is doing HDMI recording of this, such that I can actually get a recording out of this. In fact, actually, humorously, I had a really crazy way I was going to try to record this. I forgot to turn on. But the goal was to get John to do an HDMI recording of this, and so hopefully we have that.
What?
No, he did not record it. we have HDMI. I saw the guy turn it on. It's right down here. Yeah. And so we actually have a recording of this. And so I keep doing this talk at like hackathons with people. There's some of the college students have actually never taken the architecture classes. Some of them have, but I've been trying to optimize it. Like when I first was doing this, it was taking hours for me to do this talk, and I've now got it down to 45 minutes. So this is the first time I've gotten it to 40. Like the last time I did it, it was about an hour, and I was like, I really bet I can get it to 45 minutes this time. So. Yes. I do not have a version of this using qubits. I do not know how to do that. Yes. Could this be achieved with quantum computers? I mean, you can. Could I make a simple diagram to explain quantum computers to you, or could a quantum computer be built out of wires and magnets? So the theories that I'm talking about are how current computers work. I mean, instead of using relays, you use transistors, which are about the same high-level process. From a computer programmer's perspective, a transistor and a relay has effectively the same interface, but they have very different implementations. But a quantum computer is a very different way of doing computation. It's got a bunch of linear algebra that's being performed by the state of the system as it is moving between things, and it's different. You're not just transferring information from one place to another, because this entire concept of computing will have the speed and performance of no matter how you build this. Quantum computers are a different way of approaching the problem. I can't tell if Carl's praying this is over or if Carl's... All right, I think we're done. Thank you so very much.